Hello and welcome to Unreal Engine 4, the full tutorial for beginners completely in English. At the beginning, I will show you what we will do in this tutorial. We will build this landscape, we will integrate this sound, we will create this fire, we will integrate palms that blow in the wind, we can walk through flower meadows that also blow in the wind. Of course, we set the post-process volume so that we can play with the sun. Among other things, we will integrate a cave with fireflies and a waterfall later, and we will input a weapon inside that we can pick up. Okay, so that's what you can expect after this tutorial series. Altogether is close to 4 hours. You will have created a similar level. I hope you join and see you soon. Hello and welcome to this Unreal Engine 4 tutorial for beginners. In this ultra-long tutorial series, we will create a game level with everything that goes with it. Model the landscape, character animations and controls, inventory, change weapons, an underwater world, a cave, enemies with AI controller, particle systems such as fire, fog and waterfalls. We will also model 3D objects such as stones, weapons and so on in Blender. Create textures yourself and much more. Since you are watching this video, I strongly assume that you have already installed Unreal Engine 4 on your computer. If not, please download the Epic Games Launcher and install the Unreal Engine 4. There is also the fantastic marketplace where countless assets and plugins are available, sometimes even free of charge. It is worthwhile to have a look there more often. We now open Unreal Engine 4 and get started right away. The project window now open. In this tutorial we use Blueprint and the third-person variant as a template. A look at the other templates is a must if you are permanently using Unreal Engine 4. The Blueprint Visual Scripting System is a complete gameplay scripting system based on the concept of using a node-based interface to create gameplay elements in Unreal Editor. As with many common scripting languages, it is used to define object-oriented classes or objects in the engine. If you use Unreal Engine 4, you will find that objects that have been defined with Blueprint are also colloquially called blueprints. In the settings, we use Desktop Console, Maximum Quality and the Starter Content. For this tutorial, the Starter Content contains many textures, materials, blueprints and effects that you can use freely in your project. Now we have to give the project a name. You give it the name you like, I call it TMS. So you can get started with a click on Create Project. So our project has now opened and it starts with a demo level from Unreal. It is a third person level where the character is already fully integrated. We can try that out right now by pressing the play button up here. With W, S, A and D keys control the character as in a usual game. The space key is ready to jump and you can see the character is already fully functional. By pressing the escape button we leave the play mode. If we now hold down the right mouse button and then again with W, S, A and D, we can zoom the camera around the level. This now works at a certain speed that you can adjust. This is a very important function because of course you have to scroll back and forth much faster in large levels to get the right place. The button for the camera speed is up here. The camera speed for me is currently 4. If I now increase the whole thing to 7 for example and then press S and W for back and forth and A and D for left and right, and you can see that we can scroll flexibly. I switch it back to 4 so I can scroll more softly. And now we actually start with what we are planning. For this we click on File, New Level above and use the default template. The default template has the advantage that some elements that we would otherwise have to add are already integrated, such as the skylight, the light source and the atmospheric fog. We don't need the fair reflection capture now. We select it and press the left mouse button to highlight and then click remove for remove. Also mark the floor, press left mouse button, then press remove so that the floor disappears. With the right mouse button and S and W, you can zoom in and out again. But we are kind of in a no man's land here now. So now we need our landscape. To do this, we press landscape up here. You can now see a green grid. This is where our landscape comes in. What we are going to do now, we want to create a new landscape. Alternatively, we can do an import from file and import a height map. A height map is a graphic file that contains the differences in height and depth and creates a landscape from it. But we want to design our own level, which means we use create new. We leave location, rotation and scale the same. I change the section size to 31 by 31, which will absolutely sufficient for our project. You can of course make it bigger, depending on what you are to do. But try to take part in this tutorial and stay at 31 by 31. The next option is sections per components. For this tutorial, I use the 1 by 1 section option. With numbers of components, we leave the default at 8 and with overall resolution at 249. Now it's very easy. We just click on create and then we have our landscape. Now we go back up here to the bottom on the left, then right mouse button pressed with S, W, A and D, we can scroll again. Of course, that's too slow for me now, so I increase the camera speed. Now I can see the complete landscape. Below is our player. At this point the player starts, but it is now below the landscape. So that it can move on the landscape, we have to move it vertically upwards. We can now scroll to our landscape, but that's too cumbersome for me. The better method is to click on an asset that is on the landscape. We double click on the light source or the skylight in the world outliner, for example, then we reach the light source object on the landscape. So now we are pretty much where we want to be. We now see that the player is stuck in the landscape. Of course, we don't want that, so we mark the player with the left mouse button. Then you can move it with the green, red or blue arrow in the X, Y or Z direction. In order to achieve an exact positioning on the landscape, we pull the player into the air with the blue Z-axis arrow upwards. Then we just press the home button and the player positions itself perfectly on the landscape. This is the best way to position assets directly on the landscape surface. But don't forget to move the player in the correct X or Y direction beforehand. So up, again, end button, perfect. Then press play and the character is on the landscape. Now you can see right away that C31 by 31 were not an understatement. Our landscape is big enough to work with. With the escape key we leave the play mode. We press the right mouse button and simultaneously S, A, W or D to move across the landscape. First we have to get acquainted with the possibilities of landscape building. We go back to landscape and you can already see our brush here. We now use the sculpt tool. Hold down the left mouse button on the landscape and thus model a mountain. Amazing! If we press the shift key, we can move the mountain away or reduce it, or dig down into the landscape. You can also use this method to create rivers and lakes. With Ctrl key and Z you can undo the actions. Now we come to the other tools that are available here. That was the sculpt tool. As a reminder, up with the left mouse button and down with the shift left mouse. The next one is the smooth tool. We can use this to smooth the landscape. If you work on the landscape with it, it becomes even smoother. And you remove the edges. This is the smooth tool. Then there is the flatten tool. With this tool we create an even surface by pressing the left mouse button and in a deepening I can expand the trench at ground level. When I use the flatten tool on a mountain, I expand the landscape at the height of the mountain. It can be used to create very beautiful plateaus. And as I said, also rivers and lakes. With tool strengths, you can set the strength of the selected tool. In example, whether it should be used weakly or very firmly. If the tool strength is set to 1.0, the painting tool reacts very uncompromisingly. The best thing is to do just experiment with it. In brush settings, you can set the brush size. This should be set very low if you want to add small elements. In this case too, I recommend that you try out the options. With Ctrl Z, I undo the design because it now looks very nonsense. In the landscape editor, we switch from flatten to ramp. Now we can integrate a ramp. We won't see anything in the first state here, so we will use the sculpt tool. That works now. I set two dots and press the add ramp button. Now I set the brush size a little bit higher and we model a few mountains here. Now we are switching to the erosion tool. This tool simulates erosion by the movement of soil. The hydro erosion tool is similar. It simulates the erosion caused by rainfall. If we use that, you can clearly see how the water worked. The next one is the noise tool. This tool randomly makes bumps in the landscape. You have to be careful not to set the tool strength too much. Otherwise, small mountains and lakes will arise again. We do not set the tool strength too much and can thus integrate random small bumps in our landscape. This makes our landscape look much more authentic and realistic. The next tool is the so-called retopologize. We will reduce the brush size because it is set too high. The retopologize improves the polygons, which means that if you have too many edges in it, you can improve the polygons for the objects. If you apply retopologize to these mountains, you will see almost no effect, but the inaccuracies will disappear in the game. One should not use retopologize on the whole level because this creates offsets that are very memory intensive. The next and last tool I present here is the visibility. The visibility cannot currently be selected. Unreal shows a red warning message. A landscape visible mask is missing. With this tool we are able to make holes in our landscape. We will come back to this topic later. We want to integrate a cave later anyway. I'm now switching back to Sculpt and there are various other brushes like Alpha, Pattern and Component over there. There's also a smooth with falloff that we used earlier. Falloff can be set here and you can see very clearly what that means. The white is stronger on the inside and weaker on the outside. This is the so-called falloff. If I set the falloff to 1.0, there is a very strong falloff. If I set the falloff to 0.0, then we have no falloff at all. Then it just goes straight up straight. So that was the smooth falloff. Then there is linear and spherical. Play around with the options given so that you can familiarize yourself with the different settings. Just play now with the tip falloff. Nothing is visible on my landscape. Oh, I've set the tool strength far too weak. Now I can increase the tool strength. And now I see that the tip falloff is sharp in the center and smooth at the edge. Experiment with different settings and try to model a beautiful landscape with mountains. Don't forget, Practice makes perfect. I'm going to start from scratch, as I planned the whole thing for the tutorial. And I'll see you in the first chapter with the landscaping. Let's start with the landscape for our tutorial. I hope you have practiced a little before and we are now applying all the features that we tried before. I'm going to take the sculpt tool and make a little raise. Then I switch to the flatten tool and model the mainland at the same height. I use the landscape on the zero level for the ocean. This has the advantage that I don't have to lower the ocean, I simply raise the mainland. As you can see, you can do it very evenly. Now I'm going to add a second level, so that you can separate it a bit between the beach and the grass and everything else we have in mind. Now we use the flatten tool to enlarge the landscape level as well. There are a few corners that I forgot, then you can edit it later, but that's not a problem. You can improve it later and investigate where you still have one or two deficits. So, now we can use the smooth tool to smooth the edges cleanly in a smooth transition. The whole thing now looks rather inconspicuous, but since this is a very large area, you will recognize the height differences when running. Please pay attention to the difference in altitude. Of course, you also have to make sure that the character comes up the heights and does not get stuck or only runs against it. Now we start the mountain landscape. We start the mountain landscape on the edge of the landscape. It delimits our landscape and it looks much more compact. It is only important that we build a higher mountain in the middle. You can also build it on the left or right side. It should be a bigger and higher mountain because we want to integrate a cave later. Now I'm going to make a few hills on the left. Oh dear, that was too far. I have to correct that because it is always already in the water. You can model it yourself as you want. I like my design at the moment. If we start the game now, oh wait, play from here I haven't explained to you yet. Right click in the main window and select play from here under preview. Now the player starts at the desired position. This can check whether everything is accessible. At the moment it looks very good and the flatten smooth functions also make it accessible. If not, you can of course still improve it, so don't worry, everything is always adjustable. Now we are building a small island into the sea. We use the sculpt tool and use the left mouse button to create a small hill. Check again, right mouse button and play from here. To check your landscape in the game mode more often is very important, so you don't miss anything what's not reachable. One notices immediately that the island is very high. I will have to make it smaller. It will probably be difficult to get it up there. I'm going to minimize the island a little bit now. Oh, that was making it bigger. That was totally wrong. I forgot to press the shift key. We are now using the smooth tool to make the island plump. Now the island is nicely flattened so that you can easily reach it from the water. Maybe a few more small steps on top with the sculpt tool so that you can see a few small points. And we do that with short left clicks. It looks pretty nice now. I think it fits. It is supposed to be just a small island that visually enhances the landscape. Now let's add some erosion to make the whole thing look more realistic. Erosion makes the landscape look much more natural. Paint over the mountains with a brush and take care of your tool strength. You can see that there is no use on the island because it is just too round. Now we use the hydro erosion tool to see where the water left its mark. Of course, this is also a very interesting story in the sea, since a few holes appear on the bottom of the sea. And accordingly, the landscape becomes a little more interesting bit by bit. Now we come to retopologize. This is a tool with which the polygons are repaired. In example, the edges are corrected via offset. This makes the island, the landscape, look better in game mode. As already said, please do not apply to everything, as this function is very memory intensive. In our level, we can do that with confidence, because we currently have nothing more than this landscape. What do we have to do next? The landscape still looks bare and empty. That's why we are adding more details to the landscape. We try to make our mountain landscape more interesting and decorated. Go ahead and play around with all sorts of tools. Take your time to make it good. Your landscape definitely doesn't have to look exactly like mine. It is important that we have a sea, an island, and a mountain, no matter left, right, or behind, where we can later integrate the cave. Next, we use the noise tool that I mentioned earlier. This creates unevenness in the landscape. Take care of your tool strength again. If the tool strength is set too high, then hills and valleys will appear. Then it can happen that the player character falls into the hole and can no longer climb out. Noise is done now. I take a last look at my landscape and think that it already looks very good. But I still want to make a few changes. I will now decorate the mountains and hills so that the landscape does not look like a cheap comic book. To do this, I use the sculpt tool to make a few short left clicks to achieve additional deformation. I already imagine where I would like to place the rocks later. Take your time for this, because the fine work brings the landscape to life. Play around with the tools as usual and model the landscape according to your idea or your storyboard. Imagine where you want to place objects later and prepare this as much as possible. The more time you invest in the landscape, the more detailed it becomes. Do your best. That looks really nice. Here I have to work a little more precisely. Very well. And now even without textures and materials. It looked like a mountain landscape. I think I can continue to work with this landscape model. The mountain still looks a bit egg-shaped up here, but the result is already acceptable due to the fine work. I am now very happy with my landscape. I have integrated many small details. As I said, you can always change it later, if you want to add or remove something. In the next chapter, we will continue with textures and the landscape material. Please save the project and then continue with chapter 2. Welcome to chapter 2, landscape material. I hope you succeeded in your landscape as you imagined it, and now we start with the material. For this we need textures, and we will now create a new folder. So right click in the content folder, new folder, and we call it textures. That's where our textures come in now. We double click this folder so that it opens. Then you can import the textures from the textures landscape folder into Unreal, which means you mark all files and simply drag and drop them down into the newly created textures folder. Unreal immediately recognizes that something has changed in the project structure and imports these 6 textures. The following files should now be in your folder: sand, grass, and rock. These maps are also called diffuse maps. These are the so-called color and image maps. We also have a normal map for each texture. The normal map defines the differences in depth and height, so that the material appears three-dimensionally in a two-dimensional space. Then we go back to content and start with the actual material. And we are going to create that right now. For this, we now need a folder for materials. Which we are now creating. With a double click, we open the material folder, right click, and off we go. Up here, we can already see create basic asset material. Press material. We select the material and give it the name landscape underscore M for material, so that we can later know what type it is. You can also call it underscore MAT or underscore material or underscore something what you like. The main thing is that you know what you meant by it. Now we click on the landscape material and the material editor opens. You can take the editor window up here with the left mouse button and insert it into the project. So you can switch between the individual tabs. Then it covers our actual project window, and that's why I pull it out again, to be able to work better. If you have a second monitor, it is of course much easier to work with. Then you can simply slide out the material editor and have a much better overview. So now we are moving the landscape material mode to the right. It's really easy to make such a material. We are going back to the textures and we just import it down here. I'm starting with the sand now. I just pull the sand in here. There are three ways to get the texture into the material. One is drag and drop. Now I delete it again with the delete key. So I have marked the texture in the assets below. There is also the other method. I press the T key, hold it down, and press the left mouse button. This creates also a texture sample. The third variant works with the right mouse button. Enter in the search field texture sample and select it with a mouse click. Here on the left side, I can assign the texture. For me, the texture is now automatically called sand gravel because it was marked in my texture folder. If the texture is not selected in the texture folder, you can now assign the texture here under browse by entering sand gravel. Then the sand gravel texture appears in the texture sample. Now these are the three methods for assigning a texture. To create a material now, I just link the color information to the base color, and you can already see it in the preview window that we already have the sand material here. This may take a few seconds. In the preview window, there are still various surfaces on which we can test the material. It depends on where it is to be mapped. This allows you to get a better overview, so nothing works here. Then we stay with the spare object. That would be the sand. But we now want to create a landscape material, and the landscape material is not just a texture. For us, it consists of three textures, namely grass, rock, and sand. That means we break this connection here by touching it with the mouse pointer. This highlights it, and to remove the connection, we press the Alt key and the left mouse button. It is now removed. Now comes the essential. We need three textures for the material. The first is the sand, the next should be the grass. We just put it below the sand. It doesn't really matter how you arrange it, but of course we also want to keep it a bit clear. Now we add the rock, and now we have integrated three textures. We now have to summarize these textures in a blend. You can imagine the blend as follows. We have three channels, sand, grass, and rock. Between you can switch back and forth while landscaping or painting. For this we need a blend. This is a so-called landscape layer blend. With the help of this landscape layer blend, we can assign several textures in the same material at the same time. Nothing is assigned at the moment, so we have to tell it how many different textures we have. At the moment, there are three, which means we can define the layers here in the material expression on the left. There are currently zero elements in the array. We now press the plus sign three times, once for sand, once for grass, and once for rock. For a better understanding, we unfold the first one. An array always starts at 0, but the numbering makes three elements, 0, 1, and 2. Then we click the arrow button here to expand the array and give it a name. I call the first array sand. We keep the remaining options. The second array numbered 1 becomes grass and the third becomes the rock. So now we have a layer of sand, a layer of grass and a layer of rock. Now we link the texture sand with the texture layer blend in the layer sand, then the grass with the layer grass and the rock with rock. And the end result goes into the base color. We have now completed the first half of the material. I will arrange the nodes a little bit more because we still need the normal maps. We definitely don't need them, but it will look a lot better afterwards if we integrate them. At the top of our list is the sand template, and we take sand here again, so the normal map for sand and grass. I stay in the same order so that I don't get confused, and finally the normal for a rock. I can now click on all of them to check them. On the left over here I see the file name of the respective texture. That is the sand normal, the grass normal and the rock normal. With the mouse wheel you can zoom the nodes larger and smaller and move them with the right mouse button. Now we need another texture layer blend. I do not create this now, but simply copy it by marking, then Ctrl+C and Ctrl+V to copy. This has the advantage that I no longer have to name the individual layers. Then we also connect the normal maps with the texture layer blend. Now we combine the sand, grass and rock normal maps with the new layer blend. Please make sure that you link this correctly, otherwise it won't look very good afterwards. Accordingly, I connect the three normal maps with the texture layer blend and the result goes into the normal node. We should still occupy two other nodes. We do not need metallic with our textures here. Here is the specular node. The specular is responsible for the light reflection. You can also create specular maps yourself with various graphic programs, but in our case we simply use constants. The constant for specular can be between 0 and 1. To create a constant, we press the right mouse button and enter the term const and select it. Since we do not want any light reflection, we enter the value 0. Add material expression constant on the left. You can also experiment with 0.1, but I think 0.0 is better for grass. Next comes the roughness node. This defines the degree of hardness of the material. You can also pull out the connection as you just saw it. I show it again. So you just take out the node with the left mouse button, enter const, select it, and the node is automatically connected. For the roughness, I set the value to 1 or 0.9. No light reflection, but a 1 for hardness. I dock the material window on top of my main editor. Then you will see it better. This is now our landscape material. We now save the material by pressing the save button on the top left corner. So that's saved now. Now we switch back to our actual level and select the landscape. If it is not longer selected, on the right side in the detail window under landscape we find the slot for the landscape material. Now we switch to our content material directory in the content browser. There are also three ways to assign the material. You can drag and drop it into the material slot. You can mark the material and click on the small arrow to the right of the material slot, or you select the material via the drop-down, enter the name of the material under Browse and assign it. Now the shaders are compiled and the material is assigned to the landscape. We will wait a little bit until that is done and then we can start. To explain, I deliberately put the sand in the material above, because the whole landscape will then be covered with sand. That makes things easier for us, because we don't have to remove the grass under the sea. Now we go to landscape again on the left side at mode, but this time we do not choose sculpt but paint. Now the individual layers that we have assigned with the landscape layer blend in the material editor are already displayed. The only thing we have to do here is click on the little plus sign next to the layer for sand, grass and rock to create a layer info. We take the weight blended layer normal here and Unreal now also suggests a directory where it wants to save it. We leave it that way and just go to OK. And you can see that something is happening in the background. We do the same for the grass and the same for the rock. All these materials are now available to us. When the shaders are fully compiled, you can also see that the landscape is completely covered with sand. Now I switch back to place under mode and with the right mouse button and play from here. From here we can already walk on sand. With the escape button we exit the game mode and switch back to the edit mode. Now we can paint our landscape with the materials. We switch under mode to landscape and then to paint. We select the grass under target layers layers. Now you should set the tool strength and brush size as needed. Now we can start and paint grass on our landscape. When you draw material for the first time, it always takes a moment for it to become visible. So apply the desired material. I'm going to add some green space here. And then wait until it becomes visible. And then you can continue painting. Also try experimenting with different tools, strengths and brush sizes. I'm going to add some green space here. Every now and then he does some calculations. So we have a little green space in there. Now I've already painted to 4, since I want to have the sea here. I switch back to sand and paint over the grass. Now I reduce the tool strengths and create a transition from sand to grass. Now blur a little and you can already see that you can always make corrections here. I draw over it again with the brush, which means that we can do it as often as we want. Just try to paint the landscape with the 3 materials until you like it. You just have to practice that for a while. Of course it will look a lot more interesting later when all the lighting is set and various objects such as stones, palm trees, grass and flowers are placed on the landscape. In this chapter, however, it is only about the basic level design consisting of landscape and material. Now we will paint on the rock material and give the mountains a solid look. I just paint it over it. Since this rock material has not yet been used, it takes a short moment to calculate. I applied the material too weakly. That's why I'm now increasing the brush size so that I can apply it more densely. Don't worry about the colors at this point. You can always change and correct everything later. I'm trying to make a good transition between rocks, grass and sand here. I imagine where I would like to place objects later. Now you can already see that the textures of the rock material is patterned very small and therefore does not look good. To correct this, I switch back to our landscape material in the material editor, so that we can display the texture larger or smaller in the material, we use a texture coordinate. To do this, press the right mouse button again and enter texture coordinate. We connect this node to the rock diffuse map and to the normal map. Now we can set the texture coordinate with U tiling and V tiling. I now set both values to 0.1, which means that the rock texture displayed 10 times larger in the rock material. Now click on apply and save above, then the material of the landscape will be updated. Now you have to wait a short time until the shaders are recalculated. Now we should see a rock texture 10 times larger on our mountains and hills. That looks a lot better. The same can be done with the grass or sand. So now we are just waiting for the compiler. We should paint the back of the mountains too, but first we wait for the shaders. I don't really like this green yet. I will have to paint over it again. The grass is still so stained, so that should be ready right away. Then we can also paint the back with the rock material. Actually, the player shouldn't come to the back of the mountains at all, but this is just a demo level where you can run over a mountain and fall off the landscape. I don't think that's so important now. Now we look at the mountains again from the front, and that looks like a real mountain. Now I just have to worry about the grass. Now I still have problems with the visibility of the layers. I don't know the reason for that, but it's not so that bad. We know that this is the grass. Now reduce the tool strength a bit. That was too much again. With Ctrl Z I can go back, but that is still too much. I'll put a little less grass in here, but that's still a lot. Okay, here we have the beach. I will leave it like that now. You can of course also use a fourth or fifth material. Heads up to you. Don't do it best as you want it. And don't forget, only good quality textures create a beautiful landscape. Just experiment with that. As I said, these are the basics. You can change everything that is close to your heart right up to the end. And with all the light, fog, sun settings, we can of course play a lot with the optics. Take a closer look at your textures in game mode. We open the landscape material again. We have a texture coordinate in here. If you also dissatisfied with the sand or the grass, you can of course give the sand our own texture coordinate accordingly. The best thing is, you enter the texture coordinate, then you get what you want, then you go back into the UV and below into the normal map of the sand. The texture coordinate is now set to U tiling and V tiling to 1 by default. That means original size 1 to 1. You can now set this higher or lower until you like it. Don't forget to check apply. Of course, you can link the same thing with the grass, or if you want two textures of the same size, you can also connect the sand and the grass with the same texture coordinate. That is of course also possible. Wait, now I have to take a look. I think I made a mistake when connecting the nodes. I combined the texture coordinates of the grass with the normal one of the rock. I disconnect this connection and connect it to the normal map of the grass. Again to check. And diffuse and sand normal, grass diffuse and grass normal. Now everything should fit together correctly again. So far so good. Now we press apply and save. Then the shaders are recompiled. I sum it all up again. The textures and normal maps must all be integrated into the landscape material. They are connected to the material node via a landscape layer blend. In addition, we use a specular map and a roughness map, or define them using constants. Of course, you can only use the diffuse maps and connect them to the material node, but in connection with a normal map, specular map and roughness map, it looks much more realistic. Normal maps can be created in GIMP. For this, GIMP needs an additional plugin for normal maps. Many graphic programs offer the option to create maps. Now the shading should be finished, and I go to place as always so I don't accidentally change other settings. I'll leave it that way, and don't forget to save your level, and we'll see you in the next chapter. Here we start modeling rocks in Blender. We will also model grass that blows in the wind. Then see you in the next chapter.